got a lot to do.
We do. Bulwark prep, start looking into the engine room, and start tackling the interior stuff.
Let's get started. No one can guess what I came there to see.
In the tall trees where the coyotes howl and the frogs sing into the night, there is a big metal shed, and inside is a boat. That boat is where this story takes place.
Hello and welcome back to Magic Carpet, where the refit continues. So in the last episode, we dismantled the bulwarks. We got rid of the majority of the plywood, and now it's sort of the finishing work on the dismantling stage of the bulwarks. This is where we are removing sort of the last little layer of plywood that's still clinging on there, as well as all the sealant that was used. And this is quite finicky work, which I think are gonna require multiple steps. I'm starting just with the fine, with a chisel attachment to get the rest of the plywood off. And then as far as the sealant, I'm not totally sure yet. It might be heat gun, it might just be scraper. We're gonna have to go over it and see what works best. So yeah, that's what we've got going on. And Aladino has just started a few odd jobs inside the boat, and he'll tell you a bit about that.
I've been continuing disassembling the interior a bit more because we started focusing on the big jobs, the bulwarks, before anything else. And there's still all the plumbing and all the wiring in here. We're not sure about changing the interior yet, but for sure plumbing and wiring will be made from scratch. So I'm getting the old out, and I've been having tons of fun with this lawnmower for boat interiors. It's really nice to just cut plumbing off, because I used to do it with the X-Acto knife, and that's a bit more dangerous. So I've taken the pump out and everything underneath the sink. It's empty down there. And this is the port side wiring. I have them all in the bundles. I didn't cut those into pieces. I don't know why, actually, but I like to do things methodically. So I started taking all the attachments off, and then I cut them exactly at the end at the electrical panel, and I pulled them all the way through. So it's always one boat length of cable, but they're very stiff and old, and we'll definitely renew these as well. I didn't even get to the engine room yet. I'll continue with some plumbing in there and wiring. One of my favorite demolition tools. Well, demolition, they're just cable shears, but they work so nicely on wiring. This one is for the smaller gauge wires, when I just have to go snip snip, precision snipping. But this works really well for small plumbing and for bigger AC wires.
Okay, so while Aladino continues to remove wires, I'm going to go back to cleaning up the bulwarks, and we will touch base with you again once we've done some more work. Thank you. So, the bulwarks. The most recent development has just been trying to scrape off the remainder of the Cicaflex that was left here. And that's actually a tedious job because it doesn't come off super easy. I've been using a scraper to get the most of it off, and then once the worst of it is off, then we'll go at it with some sandpaper to smooth everything out. But I'm not gonna lie, this is one of the jobs that the satisfaction comes afterwards once you've done it. But during the process of doing it, it's not the funnest job in the world, I'll say that. So I've kind of been doing a half day of scraping the bulwarks and then a half day of something a bit more enjoyable, usually on the interior. And one of the things which I find really enjoyable is talking with Aladino about interior design elements and how we're going to set the boat up. And this is something we haven't really talked about at all yet on the channel. Partly that's because we don't have a super concrete idea of what we're doing yet in the interior, so don't hold me to anything I'm about to say, because plans definitely may change as it goes on. But I thought I'd give you a brief overview of what we're thinking for the interior. So let's go inside and talk about that. So one thing that we were sort of talking about from the beginning is this table. I think we pointed this out in our first look at the boat because it's a beautiful table and it's made with this lovely inlay. It's quite nice to look at, but the problem is it's super small. And even though I want to get rid of it and install something with a bit more surface area, I still do just really love this table and it pained me to get rid of it. And that's when I thought of an idea, which I think is brilliant, if I do say so myself. I actually got the idea from watching an interview that Gone with the Winds did about a guy on a West sail. He was converting it to electric, and he had this tiller table that he could put into the cockpit, and it basically had wooden fittings on the bottom so that it would sit snugly on top of the tiller, and then he could just remove it from the tiller, obviously when not in use, when you want to be sailing. So I think that's a great idea. You would remove this leg, obviously. We would have to make two wooden fittings so that it sit snugly and flat on top of the tiller. Anyway, that's my table idea. Now the next thing that we were thinking about changing is this settee. Now overall this settee is actually really nice. The thing I like most about it is that it's really wide. This might seem like a small thing to like, but on Magic Carpet our settees are actually really narrow, so that when you're sitting on them like this, you have to be really like squeezed in and there's no room even for your elbows to move, but this one's nice and wide. This would be a great single berth for a single person, especially when you're out at sea and you can have a lee board here. But it would also be really nice to have the option to turn this into a double berth. There's obviously this L shape in the corner here, and so it would be relatively simple to create a board that fills in this L and creates a double berth. And we've thought of one method which could work really well, and that is to have a board that's hinged here. So you can just fold it down and it sits flush with the settee when it's not in use. And you could have some latches so that it doesn't bang around when you're in waves. And then you could fold it up, latch it here, and so that you've got a flat board, you can put a cushion on. And then its third position could be folded all the way up, again latched, and now you've got a lee board. So one board with three positions, all for different purposes. One for storage, two for double berth, three for lee board. So the next corner that we've discussed a little bit is this one. We do definitely want a heater here, so we might get a new one. Now there's a few different options for how we install this heater. We haven't firmly decided on one, but one that we are considering is to elongate this whole berth so that it comes all the way to the bulkhead. And then this last little section here, basically there's just gonna be a box over it. So this
portion of the berth is really only to stick your feet in, so that it becomes a full-length berth for sleeping on, but you can't actually sit here because there's a box over it, and then on top of the box would be the heater, and I want to have a really nice, beautiful tile backsplash, like a deep blue tile, maybe. But that design idea with the box, I think it's used on some Bristol channel cutters, and it basically just allows for another practical sleeping berth here, should you need one, because right now this is too short to actually sleep on. The only downside with that is it means the heater is a bit higher because it has to be like on top of the berth, on top of this box, and it's not great to have your heater higher. Just heats your ceiling up more, and you know, it's always better to have your heat source lower since obviously heat rises. So we're not sold on that yet, but that's a potential option. Okay, and now for the galley and the quarter berth and chart table area. So for the galley, we'll make some nice looking doors to go over the shelving. And then we also want to change up these countertops. I don't know, in the camera, this deep blue might look kind of nice because colors tend to show up well on camera, I'm not sure. But in person, it's really awful. It's like this sort of cheap plasticky stuff, this laminate that they've just glued down. So we're gonna get rid of that and replace them maybe with some nice wooden countertops, maybe like a butcher block thing, but haven't fully decided, but wood I think is the direction that we're gonna go for there. But overall in the galley, I don't think we're making too many huge structural changes. It's more or less functional, I believe. Now over here in the quarter berth and chart table area, we are considering a few bigger structural changes. Again, these are not essential because this is a usable space, but we believe it can be even more usable. The main issue we have with it is that the quarter berth is really, really short. And Aladino and I are not crazy tall. I'm 5'9", he's 5'10", so you know we're definitely not outside of average. But even for us, this is quite short, so it would be really nice to elongate this a little bit. Now it seems like somebody previously has actually just cut a hole in the bulkhead back there so that your feet can stick through into the aft locker. But that's a kind of annoying solution because it means that the whole aft locker is more or less useless for storage because anything you put in there is just going to spill out into the quarter berth. So that's not a nice solution. So we're thinking of elongating this forward a little bit and then basically having a board which is removable, and then underneath is the seat for the chart table so that when I want to sit down and work at the chart table, I can remove this board here and the cushion and just flip it up and stick it on top of the quarter berth, and then I'm left with a nice seat underneath. And then as for the engine room, that's also something which might require some changes since we are putting a new engine in. And this is something we haven't really looked at yet, and I think Aladino was hoping to dive in there and have a bit of a closer look and start maybe disassembling some things in there. So I'll pass this over to Aladino now.
So this section of the boat opens up many new chapters. There is lots to do in here. Not only does the engine need to come out, but the whole engine room needs redesigning, but certainly refurbishing. If you actually look at the ceiling, it's all coming down. It's all falling apart. I'm excited about diving in, starting to rip things out to get a clear overview. And in the meantime, also see if I come up with some more solutions. An engine that is well serviceable, maybe use of space inside for some storage. Those are all things that could be possible by diving into here. Oh, there we go. This is very awkward and a bit too big. This is definitely something we're going to change. There's these rags that have been soaked in diesel.
Ew.
mysterious block of rust. Now, do you see the underside?
So we kept scraping, sweating, swearing, hunched over pieces of machinery and synthetic residues, trying very hard to focus on the bigger picture. It was a gray day, in a way that only the Pacific Northwest can be gray. In this part of the world, the weather can really set the mood. When the sun shines here, it does so with a freshness and a beauty that I've never seen paralleled anywhere else. But when it's gray here, when it rains and the tall trees sway in the chilling breeze, then it can feel downright gloomy. So perhaps it was the weather, or perhaps it was simply being tired, but we both felt worn down. Of course, we expected this to happen eventually. No one has ever said that refitting a boat is fun all the time. Sometimes there are simply jobs where your body aches and you sweat under layers of protective equipment and you go to bed exhausted and drained, feeling like you still have fiberglass itching your skin. Yes, a refit is not always a joy, and the addition of this gloomy day made it just a touch less joyous. But when days like this come, I know they're not permanent. Breakthroughs and sunshine and great surges of accomplishment and pride are also constant accompaniments to a life in a boat shed. But you've got to take your bad days with the good. That's the reality of it. And anyway, the day wasn't entirely over.
So it's late afternoon now, and I actually just came back into the workshop. I haven't been here all afternoon because I went to go edit videos this afternoon. Aladino and I are getting pretty tired. We haven't had a day off, or we haven't given ourselves a day off since arriving here. So I think this morning we were just feeling kind of tired and burnt out, and we were getting a bit snippy at each other. So I decided to go edit videos all afternoon, which is kind of my happy place. It calms me down and makes me happy, and now I feel much better. And now I'm gonna go see what Aladino has been up to all afternoon.
I was feeling like, smells good in here. that was for something. I was feeling like crap today, so I thought I might as well go ahead with the crap jobs.
What an interesting reaction to feeling like crap.
Yeah, right. So, and I've done quite all right, I might say so myself. I have cleaned the engine room, degreased it all, it smells wonderful. I have taken everything apart from the engine that I could to make it lighter. I have disassembled everything in the head. There is no more head, no more toilet, no more hoses. The only thing still there is the tank, which is underneath the floorboards. I need to rip up more floor to get to it. The only unfortunate part is that I also got to have a look at our diesel tanks. Those are located underneath the engine. Now, in general, I love the philosophy that tankage is in the keel, but for the diesel, it makes it very hard to access, and it looked gross in there. So I'm hoping I'll feel like shit again so I can tackle that job. But now I'm just, I disconnected the engine from the shaft and now I'm just lifting the engine a little bit so that it will be really easy to get off. And as you can see, there is much less in here, and that is because this also needs a complete refit. And in general, keeping old hoses, for example, is dangerous. Some materials become soft, other materials become brittle. That really is a cheap warranty when you look at it that way, that you just change all the hoses when you get a new boat. But I think we're going beyond that. We'll change all the through holes and seacocks, which I've got two huge ones right here. Those are for the cockpit. They're not quite seized yet, but they're hard to move. And even if they're bronze, after 30 years, that's also a good lifespan. So this is just the beginning, though. I mean, I cleaned in here just to make it easier on us, but this entire room needs to be sanded. The walls need to come off here, and we need to do some redesigning. This is just step one. What a day.
I'm so proud of you. I can't believe you've done this.
Thanks.
I just have to quickly tell the camera how proud I am of Aladino. We're tired and it's just been sort of a crummy day for both of us, and he just pulled through and did so much amazing work on the engine room and the head, like two of our toughest and dirtiest jobs, and he just ripped through them in one afternoon, so he's pretty wonderful. Yes, the gray mood had lifted. Often when we share moments of discontent in our videos, we'll get two main responses. Some people thank us for sharing the reality of life, agreeing that things are not always great and that to expect otherwise or to depict otherwise is delusional. And others tell us that we're being silly. That our life is so good, why waste a single moment on a negative thought? And I think both of these responses have some merit. But in my opinion, both miss the mark just slightly. And I actually believe that happiness includes frustration and discomfort and fatigue. I think the best examples of what I mean are mountain climbers, or marathon runners, or really professional violinists, or anyone else who constantly does seemingly difficult things that don't really look like happiness. Mountain climbers can have horrible days, caught in a rainstorm on some cliff face, fingers bleeding, eating freeze-dried food, cold, wet. To look at them on a day like this, you may not see jubilant happiness on their faces. But I bet that they're not sad either. They're doing what they love, and what they love is hard sometimes. They won't stop climbing mountains just because there are storms. That doesn't mean they love storms, they just love the mountains more. It's the same with marathon runners or professional violinists. Not every 5 a.m. training session is fun, not every scale is a joy to play, but both of those things are filled with purpose. The purpose means more than the temporary discomfort. And that's why the marathon runner and the violinist keep going. Obviously, Aladino and I are not elite athletes, but I do think this project has some parallels. It's a project that challenges us. It requires stamina and patience. It will frustrate us. It will tire us out. But it is always satisfying. We may not enjoy every day, but we love the overall. It keeps bringing us happiness, the deep kind.
might say that I'm a loner, but I just call it being free. I am my heart's only owner, or at least I used to be. 'Cause now a wildfire is raging deep inside.
Whew! Okay, all of the Sikaflex is scraped off. Well, not all. It's a really uneven surface, so there's like these cavities where it still is in there. And it will have to be sanded later, but the bulk of it is off. I feel great. I'm really looking forward to not kneeling over these bulwarks anymore. So as far as this exterior stuff, the next step is ripping up the decks. And that's why we're not sanding the bulwarks quite yet, because it's just a bit better to do it once the decks are off. So that's it for this episode. It's been a good productive episode. We've looked through the interior and told you guys a few of our plans. I finished scraping the Sikaflex off the bulwarks. Aladino has really spiffed up the engine room and taken the first steps towards getting that old engine out. So we've made some good strides, and we'll be back next Friday as always with more progress. As always, a huge, huge, huge thanks for watching. We're so thrilled with the reception this series has gotten. We're really excited that you are all excited about this project. And an extra big thanks to our patrons for making all of this possible. We owe a lot to them, and they're really the ones that make this all happen. And of course, an extra big thanks to these folks whose names are appearing on the screen right now for always going above and beyond to make sure that Magic Carpet keeps being produced, and we'll see you all next Friday. And if that ain't love,